Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive. And with us today is Marcia Hafif, and she is a painter. And we have a treat today, and that is that this summer we went up to New York and we spent about 3 hours, I guess it was, in your studio.
Yeah, and
we shot about an hour tape. So in the course of the hour, you're going to be able to see her actually making a painting. And the process of grinding the pigment and priming a canvas, and we are also going to see some of her living space, studio space. And I'd like to thank you, Marcia, for coming today.
Well, thank you. Thanks for inviting me.
And what we would like to do is start right off with a videotape. It's sort of like what we're going to be doing is just like we did when we were there, in a way, seeing your living space. And at this time, you've sort of separated it into two spaces.
Mm-hmm.
And you're using the one and sharing a space, which is where you're painting or your studio.
Mm-hmm.
Could we go to the videotape, please? And here we can see, as we are looking out, we can see New York.
Mm-hmm. And we can see a painting, one of the paintings at least, that was on the wall, a blue one, I think.
It's a blue. And
I wonder if we might talk about why it's not a picture of something, why it's a painting. I call it a painting, but it doesn't depict anything. I think it's the question of monochrome painting in general. It's an unusual way to put something on the wall and call it a painting.
Part of it is it's a reflective quality, which it does become an image, but it's an image that it picks up or reflects off of.
Yeah.
But it has to do with your particular choice of color, one color,
mm-hmm.
monochromatic,
mm-hmm.
and the type of surface,
right.
Because right now you're dealing with a very satin, glossy surface, is it not?
Right, a glossy surface. And that's something that particularly interested me in that. But I was thinking about the question of monochrome painting, basically. Why is it monochrome, and why is it, I think it's a bit of a surprise, perhaps, maybe not.
The surprise is an object that you're making, referring to an object of monochrome as being an object?
When one thinks of a painting, one doesn't most often think of a monochrome painting, in which case the painting itself does become more of an object, and it becomes an object in real space, real time, real space. It's not depicting something else. It's not a picture of a forest. It's not a picture of a sunset.
So the material is an object.
Yes.
The material is a subject.
Right.
And the material is, what is another one? Subject, object, and material is a material.
Right. And the focus of my work is first on the material, and then how I can use the material, how it can refer to painting and the history of painting and what painting is, what I can say about painting with my materials, and then what can this arrive at. Finally, it's not only material in the long run. It ends up being something else, but it works through the materials, through the methods of using materials, through these references to an object, which finally, I think, is perhaps an object of meditation. Maybe it's an object that focuses our attention in any case on one small area. It's an object.
Small idea.
Well, no, not such a small idea.
It's an idea as far as the immense possibilities within
right.
the world.
Right, which for me contains many of those notions. It's all together. That's why I think it's not so little. I think it's quite vast that it can contain the ideas of many paintings. One of the reasons I don't make figurative paintings is that I think that film and photography, but film can do that with many, many more images in our life around us today. And with the media, what we know of media, we know that we're familiar with many, many, many images. If I paint one single image on my canvas, it's one single image. It's not satisfactory anymore. But a monochrome image can have all the images in it, or none.
Part of your monochrome, though, is determined by the way in which you apply the material, is it not?
Yes, of course. That's
the brush stroke.
That influences the result. But it's not the choice of monochrome per se. It's the fact that it seems very important to me to use the monochrome form, and these are some of the reasons that I choose to do that. At the same time, using the materials, and so this leads to the specific result in that specific moment. So some of my paintings would have an oil surface with brushstrokes visible. Others have a satin or a gloss enamel finish on. That's usually based on wood, and so the results are very different one from another. But the monochrome idea is something that is central to all of them.
I think usually when I think of monochrome, I'm usually using the term as a singular hue, even though it has a lot of variables in it. But you give a wider scope to the word monochrome.
Do I?
I think so. And I think that's important.
How do you see that it's wider?
Well, you give it a wider scope. You give it a wider perception as in reference to the monochromatic. And I think that's important. Mm-hmm. That's what one actually partakes and perceives when they see your work.
Yeah.
So it's not the narrowness of it. It's not when you focus on the work that it's going to become less or a minute quality. Mm-hmm. It's actually opening up or expanding the potential of what it is that you are about with monochromatic.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, that feels very abstract to me. I guess I would concretize it in a certain way. I would like to think about another reason why I use monochrome in making my paintings. I think it has a lot to do with the question of what happened during the history of painting that caused a difference between figure and ground. And I think this question became much more focused when abstract painting came into being. Abstract painting led to the possibility of monochrome in a certain way, because the figures in abstraction are more related to ground, and it was more easy to move the figures away and arrive at a certain point where there's only ground and there's no figure. But the figure doesn't disappear. The whole painting becomes a figure. The painting itself, this is why the installation of my work is so extremely important to me.
And we were going to see some of those.
Really?
Yes, in the slides that you brought us.
That's right. So what I see when I look at a painting is not simply that surface of that painting. If that's what I wanted to see, I would put a frame around it. But I don't put a frame around it, because what I really want to look at, I want to look at the figure of the painting on the ground of the wall of the room, the space that the painting is in. So for me, the figure has been taken up, subsumed into the whole painting.
Well, the figure is sort of stretched over to the frame.
Right. The painting becomes
like a skin.
The figure.
It's like a skin. You have expanded
right.
on it.
Right, right.
And it becomes whatever mm-hmm. the shape is that mm-hmm. you're working with.
Right.
And most of the shapes you work with, though, are rectangular, are they not?
Almost always square.
Square?
I prefer square as a format for the paintings for certain specific reasons, partly because the square is self-contained. A vertical canvas, which I do use sometimes, has an axis which leads vertically up and down through the canvas and sends the eye in those directions. A horizontal canvas sends the eye horizontally beyond the painting. But a square is a neutral shape that contains the eye within it.
Okay, a vertical is a figure reference.
Right.
And mm-hmm. a horizontal is a landscape reference.
Right.
So what is happening by being mm-hmm. a square, mm-hmm. you have concocted somewhere between
yeah.
a vertical and a horizontal.
I've so either denied both of them, or I've brought
enhanced.
Them together.
Yes, very much so.
Mm-hmm.
What I would like to do is I would like to spend some time with mm-hmm. a few slides that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And what we have here, if I can work with the slides, the first one here
yes.
is an installation shot.
Mm-hmm. That's from a recent exhibition in London.
In London.
And we can't see closely enough to know the materials of the paintings, but each one is different, actually. One is...
We can see... Actually, the illumination that we have of the paintings actually comes from the...
From the skylight.
From the skylight, yes. And this particular installation has to do with the way in which they are placed on the wall, correct?
Yes, yes.
And mm-hmm. not in that they are like a sculptural... And an installation, it's
no.
you're using the wall.
That's absolutely right. Before I install paintings in a gallery space or whatever the space is, I make drawings of those walls. I need to know the height of the wall as well as the length of the wall, and I need to know how the paintings will fit on that wall. I've found that I like to have the painting vertically centered on the wall. Virtually, no matter what the height of the ceiling
by,
is.
By vertical, you mean that actually the paintings have a horizontal quality because mm-hmm. of one to the other.
Right.
But when you say the vertical...
I mean, if I want to find the height of the painting on the wall, I would measure from top to bottom of the wall and place it approximately in the center.
Oh, you would?
Yes.
But what happens, curiously,
uh-huh.
if the wall is a 20-foot wall?
Then I won't go all the way to the center,
which
probably.
Would be about 10 feet would
right.
be center.
But I would place the painting quite high on
In other
the
words,
wall.
You would not necessarily work at the 10 foot, but mm. you would work closer to that. You
yes.
would expand
right.
one's perception
mm-hmm.
or
mm-hmm.
one's normalcy
right.
of placement,
mm-hmm.
which is under
right.
6 feet.
Right.
For the
right.
size paintings mm-hmm. that you are working.
And horizontally, I determine often the painting is centered in the wall horizontally, although it may not be. For certain other architectural reasons within the room, there's something in the room that pushes the painting from one side to another. So the question that's important there is that when I look at the painting, as I mentioned, I see the painting as a figure, and the wall is the ground for the figure. So I want to see the whole wall, take that into consideration, not just a little bit of the wall or even the eye level of the viewer or of myself, but the whole wall. So for me, the whole wall becomes a drawing, and I'm drawing within that. And
you're working within a
right,
composite.
Right.
Yes.
So in this case, in this gallery, there were two rooms, and I had four different kinds of paintings, and it was really a mathematical...
Well, how do you define the different kinds of painting?
Well, some of them are oil on canvas.
Okay.
Some are acrylic on canvas. A few of them are enamel on wood. And others are marble dust on wood, which was
okay.
a new medium for me.
So it all mm-hmm. has to do with
right.
the monochromatic
mm-hmm.
and the additives that you use to the binder?
Well, within monochrome, my work falls into different series, so that one series may be entirely made in oil paint on canvas, another one in the enamel on wood. Most recently, acrylic on canvas has interested me, and I'm working with that right now.
I'm actually kind of surprised that you used or moved into using.
Now, why are you surprised?
Well, my experience with a lot of Europeans is mm-hmm. that they generally use oil.
And American monochrome painters usually use oil, I would say.
And mm-hmm. and so you're, not that you're European, but the element is that, to me, I see it as more of a traditional, being able to move the paint, being right. able to mm. have a little more control over it, whereas
not necessarily.
Whereas the acrylic, it's pretty. You put something down, and uh-huh. it has a tendency to stay.
Well, it dries
very quickly.
So I'm having to deal with that fact that it dries very quickly in new paintings. And when I want to make a larger one, I have to figure out how to do that and still get it to do what I want to
so
do.
So there is a change.
But the question of materials also I see as a sign in a way, a suggestion of what I want to say with this painting. If it's an oil on canvas painting, it has automatically a reference to the tradition of painting through the materials. That's another reference that is within that painting. If it's acrylic on canvas, well, that depends, because acrylic can look like oil sometimes. It just isn't. But I think the acrylic must be used for itself in the ways that acrylic functions, and I won't try to make it look like oil. Sometimes it might. Who knows?
Okay. We had this installation shot, this mm-hmm. slide, and we had, if they will go back to that, mm-hmm. thank you. Uh-huh. Are these of different sizes? There's a large one mm-hmm. at the end,
right.
and then there's a small
right.
one, the dark uh-huh. one,
right.
and then is the green, or what I see is green, mm-hmm. and the one to the left of it, are those of the same size?
The ivory one to the left and the small, apparently smaller one are the same size.
All of those three are
right.
the same size.
And the center one is green, and it's slightly bigger. And it has a wooden
edge. What determines
edge?
The space between them?
Oh,
I mean, because you more have clarified
right.
the vertical element,
right.
but here you have different sizes.
That's easier to answer with the opposite wall that we were looking at before, but here it was a little subjective. I rather wanted the ivory and the green to be a little bit closer together and with more space around the
okay,
crimson.
Those two that are on the left then have
yeah.
to do with more of a light palette. Whereas the dark,
mm-hmm.
which is farther
yeah.
removed, so you gave mm-hmm. it that a form of distance?
Yes, it's really capricious in a certain way. Well, I don't know if we have the slide of the opposite wall. It was the first slide that you showed.
The first one?
Mm-hmm. That one. The four paintings on that left wall were what set the key to the exhibition, because there were 14 paintings and they were all disparate, and it was very difficult to find a way to build a logic into the installation of them. But these four paintings are the same size. I believe they're very close to the same size. I think
they look
size.
Pretty much, whereas mm-hmm. in,
yeah.
in this other one.
But each one is of a different material. But there was something red that ran through the four of them, and something that meant that these four should be together on this wall. And when that was settled, then the other paintings took their places.
In other words, when you put those four up,
mm-hmm.
you did not have that predetermined that those
no,
four.
No, no.
It had to do with you
right.
going to the space
right.
and moving them around
right.
and trying to come to how they were going to
right.
consume that space.
Even though I had been studying the wall for a year, making drawings of it, drawing other conclusions as to what I might do there, when the paintings are in the actual space, I make final decisions, which are almost always a bit different from anything I could foresee.
Okay, that isn't the same, the reverse.
This is the green and ivory painting, but from another view.
Must be.
So
I'm not able to.
Uh-huh. that's
now
the
that's the same one that we just the second slide
right.
that we saw.
Well,
you know, seeing
yeah.
it straight on,
mm-hmm.
seeing the big
right.
one straight on.
Right. Mm-hmm. I think if we go on, there must be. Well, this is one of the oil and canvas, and there is something about canvas that immediately suggests the tradition of painting. Well, enamel on wood suggests something much more contemporary, and I want to use those signs in painting to say, this is what I'm referring to at a given moment, at a given time. I'm referring to the tradition in one painting. In another series, I'm not. I'm referring to how one applies paint and how it works and the support that it
yeah.
should have.
The one question I have is that when you use paint and it has a very enamel quality
mm-hmm.
to it, and
it is enamel.
when you think, or I think of some enamel or porcelain that,
uh-huh.
or lacquer that I would attribute to the Chinese, you know,
uh-huh.
the objects
oh,
that
yes.
they would have,
right.
but that would be something that's very old.
Yes, that's
in
true.
Tradition.
That's true.
So
mm-hmm.
in a way, what you're saying about different materials and time references,
uh-huh.
in a way, refers to more of the Western.
Yes.
Could it be?
Well, in fact, you're making me think that even within my own work, there are these two references. One, when I first used the enamel on wood, I wanted simply to make a reference to everyday life. I went to a hardware store to buy some paint in a can, and I painted it on the can, on the wood, actually. I prepared the wood. And I wanted it to refer to everyday contemporary life. But in London, I also worked with the enamel and polished it and made it very, very smooth, like ivory. And you could touch it and feel this very smooth surface. So in that case, it had a slightly different reference, a little closer to the Chinese lacquer that has to be very carefully done.
Actually, back in the 30s and the 40s, the furniture of this country, at least
mm-hmm.
my training
mm-hmm.
anyway,
mm-hmm.
was that you would take a piece of wood and you would shellac it
uh-huh.
to seal it or to,
mm-hmm.
To prime it, and
mm-hmm.
then you would put varnish on it, or varnish, and then you would use pumice stone and
uh-huh.
actually water sandpaper in
yes.
between each
mm-hmm.
layer, and you would end up with maybe four or five or six
uh-huh.
layers, and what you have is actually a varnish that is
mm-hmm.
above the wood,
uh-huh.
and it.
Right.
It has a reference uh-huh. or similarity that comes to what I would imagine
mm-hmm.
and what I've seen of the few things of,
mm-hmm.
of the Japanese,
uh-huh.
but it would also, in some ways, refer to a type of reflective quality, or maybe even a Victorian,
uh-huh.
I mean, in one way,
uh-huh.
patent leather shoes,
right,
you
right.
know, that.
Well, in London, I did work, I did polish with water, sandpaper, and so on, and really polish those paintings. But the one thing I like about the very shiny surface of the, in some instances, of the enamel paintings, is that from one angle you see purely color, from another angle you see only reflection. So the color seems to be disembodied. But then if you move around to the edge of the painting, you see that it is wood. It's an ordinary
yeah.
wooden object.
So in a way, that has almost a reference like seeing a store window in which
mm-hmm.
you have the glass in the front. And
right.
what happens is that there's reflective qualities
mm-hmm.
in it,
right.
which gives a lot of distortion.
Sometimes
changes.
From some angle you
and
can see
through.
And then
you move slightly and you see another part, and then you move
right.
and you see another, and
mm-hmm.
it almost makes something dimensional become flat
right.
In many ways.
Mm-hmm. You get a different view according to your
the
position.
Particular paintings that we had on
mm-hmm.
the screen just a minute ago, here we are.
Yes.
Were those the first four?
No.
Those were
you mean
the
of
other
that group?
Part of the 30.
Right. No, of the, there were 14 in this case. 14, and I worked on them all within a period of 6 weeks. I worked
you
with these different materials in London.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I found it to be a very agreeable place to work. I enjoyed being there. These that you have projected now are quite early paintings.
When you say early,
what? Early for me, that is. They're 1973, and these are the first paintings in which I ground and made my own paint. When I was just exploring how to, what the basic ways of using oil painting materials were, and so I bought. Pigments. I bought all the pigments I could find, actually. We were talking about how one chooses earlier. Well, I chose every color that I could find, and I took one at a time and ground it in on a glass plate with a muller, ground it in oil.
And we'll be seeing that a little later.
I think so. And so I made each pigment, and I painted that onto one canvas, so that I could see that color. As I'd been painting for some years before that, but I had never really examined one color at a time to see what that color actually looks like in itself. And monochrome gave me the possibility of doing that, to see exactly what alizarin crimson looks like.
In other words, you can maximize the singularness of something. Which is generally the only way we can really maximize something, is by focusing on something which then we can blow up, so to speak.
Which, of course, isn't the only way to see it.
No.
Painters for generations have been using mixing colors, alizarin crimson, which is a fairly new color, into other colors, and I'd done that too, mixed them up. But here was the possibility of seeing one and what that looked like.
Yeah, but sometimes when you paint it on there, it becomes something else.
It does.
It changes.
It
goes through transition.
It does. That's true.
Here we got a couple more slides to be seen, and this is this part of that whole group of these older works?
No, this is a later version. They're done in much the same way, but the canvas is somewhat different. In this case, I decided they should all be square. In the earlier version, some were rectangular. Some were square, some were rectangular. And that's why the hanging of them together is so different. Because in this case, when they're square, they neatly form a grid. I just put them on the wall to store them in a way, and this is how they came out. Well, with the earlier paintings, because of the different formats, it wasn't possible to hang them in a grid.
Now these are vertical.
Vertical, yes. But
now,
there are.
What date are these?
This is 1986, so we've jumped ahead.
Yeah, we're jumping
quite a bit.
15 years.
Right. This is a series I began in 1986. I was thinking about the city of Rome, where I did live for a number of years in the 60s, and this image of the four vertical, rather flesh-colored, rather Rome-colored paintings just came to me, and
they almost play with it,
travertine,
even though they aren't.
Right. And so that was the beginning of work that I did for a number of years, and still in the recent show in London, I had some of those, which had changed, and they'd become singular rather than modular in that way. They had, they'd become a little more pale. They transformed themselves from the Rome series to the French paintings, but I worked with that kind of a skin color. I was thinking about the skin, the color of skin in traditional paintings.
Not skin that oil gets when it.
No, of course it has that too.
Skin of one's body.
Right. No, I was thinking about the skin color as it's painted in traditional paintings.
Okay.
So there it is, paint skin, and it is representing human skin.
But paint skin is usually a little more opaque, isn't it?
Yeah, well, it depends on the skill of the painter. I think. So those rosy colored pink paintings worked for me for quite a long time for different, and I still use them, as I said, sometimes, but now I'm involved in the acrylic.
Now here's a pear.
Right.
So and very similar to the other ones done in 86, were these
right,
done?
This is 86 or 87.
And they work together, there's two of them, it's
seductive. So it becomes horizontal even though it's vertical pieces.
Because it's square.
Because it is one, I consider that to be one painting. And they are,
Well, it's two figures.
Right. Yes, that's right. In fact, I was working with the vertical then, thinking about the relation to the body, the figure and the body and the skin color.
In making reference to the body, what part of the body, would you think of it as being a torso?
I think it's a whole body.
A whole body.
A whole body, even though it's not articulated with head and feet and so on. I think it's, as a person or as the painter, put myself in front of the painting, I feel a one-to-one relationship, me to it. And that's why I think it functions like a whole body that is opposing me in a certain sense. And giving me a sense of my own body at the same time.
Okay, on this one, there seems to be the area, the ground that the painting is on is slightly different. Is that just the coloring?
No, this one is on wood. It's not commercial enamel. It's an enamel I made myself and I applied it to wood. It was the first of my wood paintings. In fact, one day I thought, I don't want to stretch a canvas. I want something else to paint on. And so I went out to the lumber yard thinking I would like a 2-foot square piece of wood. And this one is approximately that. And I brought it home. And that became the first of a series I still work with the enamels. After making my own enamel, I then went to the hardware store to see what colors they had. To the artist's paint store to choose some colors. Then I've worked in Europe, in Munich and Düsseldorf and Paris, searching the paint stores for colors that I like that seem to me to refer to those cities. So it's been
What's
a long...
What's the range of colors that you could find? How many?
Oh, well, that's interesting. I was going to say there are a lot, but it's actually fairly limited because...
I think there's more than 100 generally?
No, it depends on whose series you're looking at. In the art store, I could find 30. In the hardware store, 10, 12. In
because that's the tinning colors.
In a decorator's store, you could find infinite colors because they can mix them for you to whatever color you like. So. It depends where you're looking, how many colors you can find. Why are you interested in the numbers?
Well, I was numbers because I was trying to get for myself different colors, and really there aren't that many really different. There's only a certain basic composite, and then the rest of them are sort of variations of those.
In a way, it depends on how you think about it. It seems that the human eye can discern many, many, many different colors and shades. But then if you think about the colors necessary for painting, I most often use red, yellow, and blue. And red, yellow, and blue make green, orange, and violet of some sort. And so I usually use a rather limited palette rather than a broad one.
Okay, we have just a couple more slides that I would like to see, and this has a very tactile quality to
this
it.
This one is, what happened in this case, as I mentioned earlier, my interest in monochrome painting has to do, and has always had quite a lot to do with the question of figure and ground, and how a painting placed on a wall, especially a monochrome painting, becomes a figure on that ground. And so for this exhibition, and the next two or three slides are from the same exhibition, I believe, if you want to look at those. I worked with the dimensions of the walls in the gallery in a different way. In the first instance, I painted the entire wall with a small brush, making brush marks. That's why it has this tactile quality. In this instance, I wanted the painting to be longer than the wall and not as high as the wall. So I'm working with the dimensions of the wall. And to make it longer, I made it in three parts so that it could bend into the space. And, well, we could look at another one.
Okay, we'll look at the next one.
This one
is vertical.
Can we back up from it a little bit?
Yeah, you'll back up.
Because this one is vertical, but it touches the ceiling and the floor. So again, I'm working with the dimensions of the given space. And but at the same time, with the different media of painting. This one is a glaze medium in oil. It's terre verte glaze over Naples yellow ground. So that's in fact what I'm working with now with the acrylic paintings. Again, the glaze medium, but glaze in acrylic instead of oil. And this one is again another medium. This is encaustic on wood.
Encaustic being wax.
It's wax.
Wax added to the oil.
Yeah, and it's used warm. It's painted on while it is warm. And again, the painting touches the floor and the ceiling. But it's square in this instance. It's composed of four parts. And I don't know if you can see that there is a separation.
I can see it.
Right.
Okay, that's the element of the slides that
yes.
you brought with you.
Mm-hmm.
What I would like to do next is to show the video of you actually
uh-huh.
in your studio
uh-huh.
and actually doing some painting parts.
Well, yeah. That's the most fun.
Get into the real nitty gritty.
Well, that's where I feel really at home, is in the studio when I'm painting.
Well, those sort of go hand in hand. The element is that in painting, you use a square format,
mm-hmm.
and you usually use preparatory painting or processes of building up, like
yes.
you use the
mm-hmm.
Naples, mm-hmm. did you say Naples yellow?
Well, in that painting we were looking at, it was Naples yellow. The earlier painting, the
yeah.
large one, that was Naples yellow. When you were visiting me in my studio, I was preparing the acrylic paintings.
Yeah.
And in that
case,
could
we put that video on the monitor? Thank you. Great.
Uh-huh.
There it is.
Mm-hmm.
So
what I do for preparation and the preparation actually leads into the painting itself is to paint layers of gesso. And the reason I smooth the paint out in a vertical direction is that I want to build in a slight kind of linear texture into the gesso. So I actually paint it once in one direction and then again in the other direction, and I build a cross weave, a texture into the gesso.
It's almost like a canvas. You know,
yes.
In
fact, I obliterate the canvas.
And create
at the
your
same
own.
Time, I create my own textile.
That's not ice cream
surface.
That she's dishing out. That's gesso. That's
mm-hmm.
paint.
Right.
A primer type.
Yes.
Of.
Yes. It's acrylic
it's
gesso.
It's a flat
mm-hmm.
mat
yes.
when it dries.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll notice here that you're putting in some oil. Acrylic paint.
Acrylic color.
And,
mm-hmm.
and what color was that?
Red.
Was it a Venetian red or
no?
No, just
red.
No,
it was red, because I wanted a kind of a pink undertone for the glaze that I'm going to apply over it. So this is still preparation. This is not at all the finish.
It's mixing it
coat.
Together, stirring
mm-hmm.
it up,
mm-hmm.
almost homogenizing it
right.
in a way.
Yeah.
Well,
I put the red in to make a pink. To mix it with the white gesso and make a pink ground for the painting.
And it isn't a slow process. I mean, it isn't a fast process. It's slow. I mean, you have to work at it.
Well, yes.
Part of it is the determination of mixing it so that you get it all mixed, so that you
right.
know what you have there.
Right.
And
I don't want the red.
Because you
I don't
put
want
in
red
another
streaks.
Tint. You put in another little dab of it.
A little more.
So you wanted it a little richer.
Mm-hmm, right, a little stronger color. And it's got to be mixed, otherwise I'd have streaks in the paint, you know.
and that would be something else.
I don't want to abstract.
You don't want that.
Not in this case, no.
Have you ever done it with streaks?
No, I don't like that kind of streak. But in these paintings, when I apply the later glaze colors, the brush strokes are somewhat visible. You can see, you separate out a little darker blue
so
here.
When you you're overpainting, you're actually painting in more of a glaze, a thinner fluid?
Right, a transparent layer. In fact, two or three transparent layers. So when I finished with this gessoing work, I had already gessoed those canvases that we see. When I come to the color that I'm mixing in now, this is the final gesso coat, but it's not the final coat of the painting, because this is all preparation for transparent layers of red, yellow, blue that may go over the top. So the painting will look quite different. We didn't get to see if when it's finished.
We haven't yet.
No.
But we're still working to get that right color that we have there that we want for it. And you had what was it? Four 2-foot rectangular square canvases and and each one was going to have the same monochrome or different monochrome?
Well, they'll all be a little bit the same and a little bit different.
I'm sure you can't mix the next color with the same.
That doesn't matter, because I can get it close enough that it doesn't, because you won't see that anyway when the painting is finished. It's like an underskirt in a way. It's something that will be covered over, but it contributes to the color.
It does affect.
Because, yes, that's why I put the color in it, because it contributes to what you will see, but it is not what you will see finally. Because the final layers are transparent, that undercolor changes them, affects them. So that's what you see finally. And then I may put two or three of the transparent glaze layers. I might put a blue and then a yellow on that and then a red on that. Or a red and then a yellow and another red. So it changes each
time. Here you go. To give this primer, this undercoat.
That is a rather exciting moment of the painting when you just begin with a perfectly white, square, fresh object. And what you do to it now is going to change it irretrievably. It's, you can't go back. You can go over. You can continue.
A little trick of this, well, I guess you can't. You can't go in like we could with the slides. Oh, I'm dreaming.
Darn.
I'm dreaming. It's a great idea.
Yeah.
Great idea. Well, we'll have to work on that next year. But you'll notice how the process of applying the paint, you work within sections, like 12 sections or 16 sections for the rectangle surface. And each loading of the brush has, it's almost like you have this.
Well, there are very good reasons for doing that.
Yeah.
Have you ever painted a wall and known that you didn't want lap marks on that wall? Do you know what
that's
happens?
That's the object of it.
Well, I want to paint this, and I want to keep the edges fresh. I don't want lap marks.
Or indications of each block area, right?
So I have to work quickly, because I want to keep the paint wet while I'm still working. And yet I need to smooth it out in a vertical way. And I can't go back, really, because it dries very quickly. I work in the upper left corner, and I get that done, and the next, and the next, and the next, and so on. And so I don't want drying between. It could
happen. So you don't want ridges within it,
right?
Clarifying each painted block.
Right. So I'm not doing this for the purpose of making a grid. I'm doing it for the purpose of avoiding a grid.
And covering the surface.
Right.
In the manner that you, in the strokes.
That's
and the,
it.
Overlapping or the crossing over and creating a weave of your own, so to speak, which is the end result.
Yeah, it's occurred to me it's a little perverse to destroy the weave of the canvas and create a similar weave on top of it. But I like that kind of dissembling.
The because of the time element, I would like to have the tape pushed up a little, so that to the point where we are actually painting the small one.
Or making the paint.
Yeah, making actually grinding the paint in it. Now, right now you have a work being exhibited. Is it one or two at the?
There are four, actually.
Four pieces.
Right, the four that were on the far wall. The one of them that I was just painting. That four.
One of the ones you painted, so yeah, we'll all have to go there and try to pick out
the
one.
Exactly.
Does when you paint, is there a process by painting that you try to in any way duplicate the process as you did before? In other words, the one surface that you painted, and you did the second surface. Did you try? Is there a duplication that you think in the process that you go through?
You mean on the same painting?
No, on the second
the
surface.
The next painting.
If you had
the next
four
painting.
Yeah.
And the next.
Do you try to make them come somewhat similar or very close?
Not really.
Or do you worry
except
about that?
Well, I don't. It happens. It happens pretty much whether I am attempting to do that or not, because I, in that instance with those four paintings, I've set a way of working, and I simply do it that way. And they will be slightly different. They are somewhat different, but they're also very similar. So it's what I do.
Yeah,
it comes out that
the
way.
The imperfection of the individual.
Right. Well, I like it to have that sense of myself.
Now, what you're doing here is you have pigment, and then you have linseed oil.
Right.
And you've sort of created a circle, a mound around it, and the linseed oil in the center, and you take your palette knife, and what you're doing is you're wetting, trying to wet as much of the powdered pigment as you can.
Yes, without too much of the oil.
Without.
I need the minimum of oil that will wet the whole pile.
But the element of making a ridge, a circular ridge, is to contain.
It's like making pasta or making. Yes, I don't
and
want the oil
on glass.
Right. Well, the reason for the glass is that I'm going to use the glass muller, which is this glass object with a flat bottom, and I will grind the paint on the flat glass. The muller has a flat bottom, the glass is flat, and the paint is caught between the two of them. So that's what.
Well, the grinding of it is that you're breaking the pigment particles.
No, not actually.
Isn't there some of that?
No, very little. No, it's primarily that the oil must cover each little particle, so it must be ground enough to make the oil really surround each little particle.
Or to make each pigment, which is very fine, to absorb. Or to gain a foothold of the linseed oil into it.
Right. They have to be very well amalgamated. And if they're not, the oil will come out, the paint will crack, various things can happen. They can happen.
Well, it's important here, if you get too much pigment, it will become, well, it won't dry very well. It'll crack and create crevices.
Right.
And it'll become brittle.
But if there's too much oil, it will run and it won't hold the brush
pigment.
Mark.
And the viscosity will not be there.
Depends on what you want. If you want to paint without brush marks, you may want more oil. If you want it to be shinier, you put more oil in.
Most house paint is made so that the brush strokes don't show.
Right.
So the viscosity, it's a vertical layup with it.
So in the household painting, we don't want the brush strokes.
In yours, you're very interested in qualities of the brush stroke.
Yes.
Also, some of your newer works, the reflective quality.
Yeah. In those, I don't look for the brush stroke. I don't avoid it altogether, but it's not what I'm looking for. There's the muller, and then we passed it.
Where is it? I'm
trying to see it in our search there. There it is.
Right.
It was there, right in your reach.
Yeah, of course.
And all.
So now begins the work of grinding.
What is that like that I can think of in cooking or?
Well, it's like using a mortar and pestle, which you could use also for grinding the paint. So that's what has to be done for quite a lengthy time to get the particles evenly covered, evenly dispersed in the oil. Looks like chocolate.
Yes, yes, very much like that.
Mm-hmm.
While we go away for a minute, I would like them for him to hurry up or speed ahead and pick up where you are painting the actual painting of this piece. I think we're just running out of time, and I want to be sure that our audience gets a chance to see this. Now, this piece that you are painting is very small, and it's going to be, so to speak, finished in it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, while we are waiting for them to spin that, what we can do is show them this piece
that
you
brought.
Would you
like to see this?
Yes.
This is a small painting.
This is a small piece that has, I'll put it right side up.
Yes, it makes a difference, actually.
And this is the finished piece.
Mm-hmm. With vertical brush strokes.
Okay.
I don't know if you can see those.
Yeah. Vertical brush strokes. And if you come in close, you can see actually the brush strokes into it. And this is on canvas. So what you've done is you've sort of annihilated the tooth and the direction
of
the canvas.
Mm-hmm.
And you've created a, I don't know, am I holding it right? How should I hold it? Actually at an angle? You can't get it? Okay. What you can see is actually the strokes of the brush are visible.
Right.
And as far as the canvas is concerned, this is about a 14-ounce canvas, isn't it?
I'm not sure. It's probably a number 12. I think could be.
Yeah,
10.
That's about a 14 or or slightly there, and it's a very substantial surface.
Yeah, and it of course has layers of gesso under it too.
So about how many layers do you imagine?
Oh, two or three.
Two or three.
Mm-hmm. Probably
okay,
three.
Okay. What I would like is that we can go back to the tape, and we can see here you are in the process of painting it.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see almost the size of the brush corresponding to the size of the painting.
Yes.
The painting is about
a
foot square, so the brush is about, what, 3/4 of an inch?
Right,
Somehow there is a relationship that exists.
I have often adjusted the brush to the size on the scale of the work. Not always, I must say. But
now, this is on a wood...
Wood panel.
Wood panel, and I think that was the first time that you don't usually do oil on wood.
No, I don't. I do. I have occasionally, but I don't. It's not a traditional combination, actually. I traditionally oil goes on canvas, and wood could you hold egg tempera or casein.
Now here on this video we can see you can see the strokes almost and they're vertical.
Yes.
I mean they're not square strokes.
No. No, the paintings are usually composed of this numbers of strokes, whether they're small or large.
And what else can we help in clarifying? Look at that mark.
What is
that? We can't see that kind of interesting mark. Almost in the center.
Right.
Almost in the center.
Hmm.
We can't get that on for
That's
you, audience, but I get to enjoy it. So we have, in her work, she works primarily with oil on canvas and her new venture with acrylic on paneling. And what you saw is a piece that we actually totally videoed her producing, and it was really a lot of fun. Mm. I've actually known Marcia since 78, I think.
Since I came to Kutztown to visit.
In 78, right. Yes. Uh-huh. Hopefully in another couple of years, now it looks like a couple of years, we'll be able to get the summer program going. Uh-huh. If you read that preview, it looks like it'll be two years as far as our funding is concerned.
That will be very good.
I wish to thank you for being with us today.
Well, and thank you.
Maybe we'll have you back again sometime.
Oh, it was fun.
But I would like to thank our audience for tuning in. Mm-hmm. I would like to remind you that at the same time, 4 weeks from, we will be back again. And thank you, Marcia.
Yeah.
And we'll see you tomorrow.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community.